Hello everyone and welcome back to Easy Dentistry, a channel that makes dental education incredibly easy and interesting. We have started uploading lectures on oral pathology. We would be happy to know your feedback on these lectures. Please do comment and let us know if you like our oral pathology lectures or no. Today we are uploading a short but important topic, that is cheilitis glandularis. You can get many short answer questions as well as MCQs on this topic. But before we begin, please subscribe to our channel and put on the notification bell so that whenever we upload a new lecture, you get a notification of it. So, to begin with, cheilitis glandularis. The word cheilitis, when something related to cheilitis itis means inflammation, and something related to cheilitis is inflammation of the lips. And what is glandularis? Glandularis denotes something related to the salivary glands. So cheilitis glandularis is the inflammation of the minor salivary glands of the labial mucosa. So the name cheilitis glandularis. So, in cheilitis glandularis, there is progressive enlargement and eversion of the lower labial mucosa. And this eversion causes obliteration of the mucosal vermilion interface. So, in this diagram, you can see there is eversion and enlargement of the lower labial mucosa, and there is obliteration of the mucosal and vermilion border of the lip interface. This interface is obliterated. Also, you can see erosion, ulceration, and crusting of the lips. So, also remember here that cheilitis glandularis is a predisposing factor for actinic cheilitis and squamous cell carcinoma. So here is an important point to remember, that cheilitis glandularis have a tendency to convert into squamous cell carcinoma. You will be surely asked a question in exam on this. So the etiology of cheilitis glandularis is mostly chronic irritation. Chronic irritation results in lip enlargement, which causes inflammation, hyperemia, edema, and fibrosis. Other causes of cheilitis glandularis are self-inflicted biting, factitial trauma, excessive wetting, compulsive licking, and drying of the lips because of mouth breathing, atopy, eczema, and asthma. Now, the clinical features of cheilitis glandularis. Males are affected more than females and mostly occurs from 4th to 7th decade of life, and it is a chronic progressive condition and it exclusively involves the lower lip. So, cheilitis glandularis exclusively involves the lower lip. This becomes an MCQ question, remember it. Now, the initial symptom of cheilitis glandularis is an asymptomatic lip swelling. Now, from this asymptomatic lip swelling, viscous secretion are expressible from the ductal openings. Now, you can see here in this picture the initial symptom, which is the swelling of the lip, from which viscous fluid can be expressed from the ductal opening. Now, cheilitis glandularis has periods of quiescence and painful episodes. Sometimes there are periods of quiescence which are interrupted by painful episodes, resulting in burning sensation, rawness, erosion, ulceration, and sometimes leukoplakic changes occurs in cheilitis glandularis. Now here you can see all features like rawness of the vermilion border, speckled erythroplakic changes at some places, then erosion, crusting, and frank ulceration of the lower labial mucosa. Now, cheilitis glandularis, as we have already studied, has an increased risk of development of squamous cell carcinoma. Why it has a high risk of development of squamous cell carcinoma? Eversion of lower lip causes long-term exposure of the lower lip to irritants. The lower lip has a thinner labial mucosa because of the chronic exposure to the irritants. This thin labial mucosa increases the vulnerability of the labial mucosa to develop squamous cell carcinoma. Now, the classification of cheilitis glandularis, it is of three types. First is the simple type. Second is the superficial type, which is also called as Bale's disease. Remember this, the superficial type of cheilitis glandularis is also known as the Bale's disease. And the third type is the deep suppurative type. So easy to remember, simple type, superficial type and the deep suppurative type. Now, the simple type of cheilitis glandularis is characterized by multiple painless papular lesions of the lip with central depression and dilated canals. So this is something like the simple cheilitis glandularis with multiple papular surface with central depression and dilated canals. The second type is the superficial type, which is also called as the Bale's disease. It is characterized by painless indurated swelling of the lower lip with shallow ulceration and crusting. So this is the superficial type, in which you can see the shallow ulceration and crusting of the lips. Then comes the deep suppurative type, which is also called as cheilitis glandularis apostematosa, cheilitis glandularis suppurative profunda and mixed adenitis labialis. So these are the alternative names of deep suppurative type of cheilitis glandularis. So this deep suppurative type of cheilitis glandularis is characterized by a deep seated infection where there is abscess formation, sinus tract formation and fistula formation and scarring of the lips. So here is a pictorial depiction of the deep suppurative kind of cheilitis glandularis. Now note here that the superficial type and the deep suppurative type of cheilitis glandularis have an increased tendency to develop dysplasia and carcinoma. Now, the histopathology of cheilitis glandularis, there is no consistent histopathological features, but the lesion shows a diverse array of alteration. Mainly, the minor salivary glands of the lower lip may show atrophy or distension of acini or ductal ectasia or inflammatory changes or even fibrosis. Now, the differential diagnosis of cheilitis glandularis is actinic keratosis, atopic dermatitis, cheilitis granulomatosa, sarcoidosis and squamous cell carcinoma. Now the treatment of cheilitis glandularis, first is the identification of the etiologic factor and eradication of it. Secondly, in suppurative lesions, the bacterial culture and sensitivity test for antibiotics should be performed so that proper antibiotic therapy can be given to the patient. And thirdly, biopsy is strongly recommended to rule out the chances of actinic cheilitis and squamous cell carcinoma. So here we complete with the discussion on cheilitis glandularis. Hope you like the lecture. Please subscribe to our channel and happy studying.